thanks for inviting me to speak with this group. I'm a staff attorney at the Innocence Project, and I was going to walk through the work we do, how we go, select our cases and how we litigate our cases, so you guys have an idea of, how our organization works, talk some about, causes for wrongful convictions, and sort of efforts we've made to sort of reform, to sort of fix those causes. We were founded in 1992 by Barry Scheck and Peter Neufeld, who had been working as like clinical professors at Cardozo Law School. They also, I think, are known to folks from their work on the O.J. Simpson case, which is about 25 years ago. Our work at the Innocence Project, we take cases pretty much all over the country. We are the main Innocence Project in New York. There are a lot of other sort of local projects that are affiliated. We have an affiliation called the Innocence Network. So you might hear of like other cases that involve Innocence Project, like the Innocence Projects of Georgia, West Virginia Innocence Projects, to just give you an example. That's not our office in New York, but we are sort of affiliated through this Innocence Network. And the mission of our work is sort of twofold. We take individual cases and exonerate the innocents through DNA testing. But we also want to sort of address the causes of wrongful convictions. And that's sort of informed by the casework, the individual cases that we take, that we can sort of dissect them, if you will, and sort of get an understanding of what was it that sort of led to the wrongful conviction, that we can sort of get a better understanding of that, and sort of address it system wide. So just to give you an overview of how like we sort of take a case, and I'll sort of talk in more detail about each one, is there's first this sort of intake process where we decide whether or not to take a case. There's the evidence search. We then will litigate for access to the evidence or to do an evidence search. We'll then do the DNA testing, and sort of depending on the DNA testing results, we'll do post-testing litigation. And then sort of depending on the outcome of the case, whether or not that will sort of lead to sort of wider reforms. And I'll talk more about each step along the way. So this is sort of, I don't know if this is quite represents, I guess this is kind of representative of our intake filing room. We get thousands of cases, requests from folks. People will write to us asking for our help, and they will sort of generally hear about us through the news, through other sort of folks in the prisons about our work, and they'll sort of write to us asking for our help. That's sort of the beginning stages of our work. And we are fortunate enough to have our organizations large enough that we actually have an intake department, which I believe there are about 11 folks in that department who sort of do various aspects to the intake process. But they're the ones who sort of first engage with our clients. And the sort of general question that we sort of look at in what we're taking is, can DNA testing, can it prove a defendant's innocence where they can be excluded from biological evidence left behind by the perpetrator? So what I tell people is that the presence of biology has to be there in a case for us to even consider taking it. So that sort of lends to the fact that we take cases more of like the sexual assault nature, like homicide cases, because those tend to have a lot of, because of the way the crime's committed, a lot of biological evidence exists that can be tested. We don't know at that stage whether or not our clients have been, if their innocent or not. And I think that's sort of a question we often get, like, do you know if the client did it or not at this sort of intake stage? And the answer is we don't. What we do know is that the sort of facts of the case that there is biology that can be tested, and if it is tested, could prove the client's innocence. I think an example is if there's like a sexual assault case, and if a client writes to us and says, I'm innocent of this sexual assault case. It was a consensual sexual relation we had. That's not a case we're going to take, because DNA testing of the biology isn't going to prove your innocence, because you know, your defense isn't that you weren't there. It's that it was a consensual relationship. So we can't prove that through DNA testing. If, however, your defense is I wasn't there, they got the wrong person, then testing the sort of evidence in that case would prove your innocence. So that's the kind of case we would take. And sort of, we sort of get to that answer both sort of in engaging with the sort of client when we ask for information. We sort of ask what sort of things about that, but we also will review sort of trial transcripts and get a sense for what the case was and what the defense was to sort of see if it's a kind of case you can take. The intake process takes a long time. That's for a couple of reasons. One, you know, we get a lot of people write to us. So there's a long sort of queue of people who are requesting our help. The other thing is that it's a pretty intensive process to sort of get to a point where we can make an informed decision as to whether or not to take the case. So that involves sort of collecting as much sort of police reports, lab reports, trial transcripts, and getting as much information, because what the intake team will do is they will sort of do a sort of initial screening and sort of then present to the legal team, which is where I work, to sort of recommend or not recommend. We have a meeting to decide whether or not this is the sort of case to have. So that does require a lot of information gathering, which takes a lot of time. You're dealing with snail mail a lot. Sort of getting documents takes time. So it is a several year process for us to sort of work up a case sufficient to even consider taking a case. So, you know, one of the things that is, you know, when we just sort of decide to take a case, one of the hardest things to do, and this usually is where in some ways a case is sort of hinges on, is the availability of the evidence. Because as I mentioned before, the thing that we're looking about is the presence of biological evidence. Like, did that exist in the case? So, you know, you're talking about, let's say, a 1983 sort of murder case, and there is sort of some blood, you know, some blood stains at the crime scene that were sort of recovered that could be really indicative of the perpetrator. Maybe the case is that, you know, the perpetrator was bleeding at the crime scene and they recovered this blood stain. So it's like, great, this is the kind of case we want to take. The next issue is sort of locating that blood stain that was collected, you know, 30, 40 years ago. And this is sort of a picture of an actual, like, real evidence room of a police department. They're not very well organized. Things are mislabeled. And this is sort of a big part of our job and our success is in our ability to find the evidence. And getting the evidence is kind of can be sort of gets into the litigation component to it. There's a couple ways you can sort of get the evidence. We sort of will try on our own to find the evidence by calling around, going ourselves to police departments, courts, hospitals, wherever we think the evidence is, and we're sort of piecing everything together based on the reports to see if they will agree to help us to find it. And, you know, they're under sort of at this stage, no, our cases are sort of way out of court. So our clients have been convicted of the crime, they're serving at the sentence. So they have no real leverage that anyone has to help us find evidence of this age. So sort of a skill and sometimes luck in terms of getting someone who's going to help you to sort of find the evidence on our own. And that's sort of one way we sort of do it. Freedom of Information Act request, just asking people if they'll sort of look. Sort of another way we can do it is sort of ask if the prosecutor will help us sort of look for it. You know, sometimes they will do that. I think at this stage, we've garnered enough sort of a pretty good reputation that when we sort of tell a prosecutor that we're sort of looking at a case and we're interested in it, that they will sort of take our request seriously and sometimes will help. That's not always the case. So finding the evidence and sort of getting it is like one thing. So even if you get that, that's not sort of the end of the story. The next thing, and this often involves actually going to court, is sort of filing a motion with the court asking that they will grant DNA testing. I mean, you can imagine, as I was saying before, the case is over, conviction has been final, you know, client serving out their sentence, and that we're in a stage where we're asking a court, hey, court, you know, remember that case way back in, you know, the 70s, 80s, 90s. Well, we want to test this evidence again. And thankfully, and this is sort of a lot of work through our policy department, where we have a policy wing that does a lot of sort of working with legislatures about enacting laws that sort of allow for it, make it easier to sort of prove innocence, is that all states have these post-conviction DNA testing laws. So that's where we sort of have to sort of operate, is that we will file motions under this, under these statutes saying, court, you know, we want to test this item of evidence for DNA, and sort of they all have sort of various prongs that you have to meet, and we have to sort of litigate that. Sometimes prosecutors will agree with our, won't contest our request, and sometimes they will, in which case you sort of have a contentious, you know, you have litigation going on around that. The testing we do, the sort of main testing that goes on is shorthand STR, short tandem repeat testing. Won't sort of bore you in sort of the sort of specifics about it. I feel like I know a surface level, like, it's like the top of a glacier. Like, I know a little bit at the top, but I know there's a lot more at the bottom below the ocean. So I know enough to sort of get by in a court context. But basically what DNA testing does, I don't know how familiar people are in the forensic context, is that we've mapped the human genome. So we know all these sort of different locations on the human genome that sort of code for different things. And in the forensic setting, what they've done is they've located, I think at this point it's about 22 locations on your sort of your chromosome that sort of don't code for anything, but people are unique at that location. So that what happens is when you get a DNA profile in the sort of forensic or criminal context, you're sort of just looking at 22 out of, I think, the millions of different locations. And these 22 are supposed to be unique to sort of people. And that's the sort of profile that we get. And one of the challenges we have in our DNA with the evidence in our case is that oftentimes they're highly degraded. As I was sort of describing, these are very old cases. Sometimes they're not kept in the best of sort of storage, the most pristine like storage conditions. So they're degraded and they're often very small amounts of DNA. So, you know, as I sort of describe, and the challenge is like you locate the evidence, you sort of then maybe you have to file a motion to justify your testing, and then you do the testing on the evidence. And, you know, it's not always guaranteed that just because of the condition of the evidence that you will get a sort of meaningful profile from that evidence that will sort of identify who did, or at least can sort of exclude your client as a person. And I've had... Sadly, I feel like a spate of cases recently where, you know, actually, and sort of both, like one where you get the sort of, you sort of litigate the testing, and then you get the testing, and there's you know, the results aren't very clear because of the samples, or I've had recently a very frustrating case where, you know, we got, you know, it was a case where we had talked with the police department up front, and they told us it was sort of a sexual assault case. They're like, yeah, we have evidence from your case. I have a bag here that lists the evidence and says sexual assault kit. And we're like, yeah, fantastic. And we got the state to order testing, and we sent it to the lab to sort of test the evidence. And they're the ones who opened the bag for the first time. They're like, yeah, it says sexual assault kit on the outside of this bag, but I'm looking inside and there's no sexual assault kit. And it's like, oh, you gotta be kidding me. And we're sort of still in the process of trying to find this sort of very critical piece of evidence. So there's no shortage of sort of obstacles to sort of get to when you're sort of going through this process, because, you know, it is really tricky because there are so many ways this thing can break against you. One other thing I want to, you know, we've been able to exonerate, I think the most latest numbers are 375 people have been exonerated from DNA testing. 21 have served time on death row. Our work sort of spreads over 37 states and DC. 62% are African Americans, 30% Caucasians, 7% Latino, and 1% Asian. 10% are juveniles. Before I sort of get to this slide here, I think just want to make something clear is that once you get testing, you sort of do the DNA testing. And if you do get positive results, you then sometimes it requires you to sort of file one more motion. That's that the conviction should be vacated based on this DNA evidence. You know, sometimes, a lot of times, you're testing really probative crime scene evidence. So it would be the sexual assault kit in a sexual assault case, or sort of some piece of evidence that was clearly something that would belong to the perpetrator. So when you get a profile that excludes your client, sometimes prosecutors will agree that, okay, you're right, that would change, that would make a difference in the case, or that proves your client didn't do it. Sometimes what we can do is, from those profiles that we develop in the crime scene, we can upload them to the conviction offender database that's kept by the FBI and actually identify someone, you know, who is there. Because when you're convicted of a crime, you have to sort of provide your DNA, and it's sort of kept in this database. So you know, sometimes we'll say, wasn't our guy, you have this convicted offender at the crime scene, that will also sort of prove innocence. And then, you know, it's interesting. It's like, once you have that DNA or that exclusion, or maybe the hit to the wrongful conviction, it's almost like people then sort of look at the case in a completely different way. And it sort of changes assumptions that people made about what, you know, you kind of like look back at the case and like, wow, well, it wasn't, you know, client. Well, how do we get to this? And that sort of learning process, or the thinking through, is in some ways, I think what will be, I mean, I don't want to understate the importance of the individual impact that the Innocence Project makes in terms of getting wrongful, people have been wrongfully convicted of crimes out of prison. I mean, to each individual, that's an incredible, I think, thing. But I think if you think about what the change in conversation around criminal justice reform, I think the fact that the Innocence Project has proven that wrongful people get convicted wrongfully, and here are the sort of causes of it, which this sort of slide talks about, I think has really shaped the conversation and how prosecutors believe sort of behave and what are best practices. And I think the idea is that that will be sort of longstanding, and that we can sort of get away from the idea that people can get wrongfully convicted. You see that of our sort of DNA exoneration, 69% involve misidentifications, 33% involve confessions, which I think is a very interesting thing, because I think a lot of people have the idea that, you know, people, you know, don't say they did things that they didn't do. And I think that our the thing about our sort of work and sort of DNA testing exonerations, that it's scientific evidence proving that they didn't do it. So that it sort of makes you rethink confessions and how do they come about and how much weight should we be putting onto them. And there's a lot of science behind that, as well as the eyewitness identification field that has sort of looked at memory. 46% are misapplications of forensic sciences. And that's, you know, situations where there might be some valid way of doing something, but it's misapplied in a forensic setting, or it shouldn't be used in a forensic setting. And some of it also involves stuff that isn't valid. Forensic odontology, hair microscopy, which are sort of comparisons of patterns, have, I think, are an example of that sort of misapplication of forensic science. 17% involve informant testimony, which is a big red flag when cases are built on witnesses who were incentivized to give testimony that they are. That's often used. It's often used in very serious cases. You see people in jail coming forward, but those are red flags that those witnesses aren't reliable. And I think what's interesting too is 11% have actually pled guilty. So that meant people went into court, sort of even a step beyond a confession. It's similar to confession, but even in some ways beyond that, that they went into court. They were presumably provided an attorney, advised of rights, and said something in open court, claiming to have done something that DNA has proven that they didn't do. And I think that has led, I'm on some sort of task force with talking about plea bargaining, because that's a big part of the criminal justice system these days, and rethinking about how we feel about how prevalent plea bargaining is when we know that people plead guilty to things they didn't do. And how can we create a system where rather than incentivize people to taking pleas, disincentivizes that, so that that's not the case. We were talking about this before. I mean, preventing wrongful convictions is really, really is important on the human toll that it has on people's lives. I mean, when you work on these individual cases, it's really heartbreaking when you hear about people spending decades in prison for things they didn't do, the relationships that in their lives that are destroyed as a result of, being incarcerated in that way, the loss that people experience, loved ones passing, parents passing while they're in prison for things they didn't do. So sort of all that put together, the human toll, I don't think can be ever sort of calculate or quantified in a way. As this sort of slide talks about, most cases don't involve DNA exonerations. We were sort of talking about 375, and I know David has is friends with the Quattrones, who I think are associated with the National Registry of Exoneration. I mean, there are over 3,000 exonerations, which I think represents just the tip of the iceberg. And the reason why I say that is that one thing I think people should appreciate is that it is incredibly difficult to get back into court, after you've been convicted. And some of the times, I think the U.S. court system is very big on finality. You read a lot of cases and they'll say like, well, you had your trial, you had a lawyer, it seemed fair, that's it. It's very hard to get back into court. The laws are sort of set up to have very strict sort of timing requirements that you have to appeal within a certain amount of time. And, oftentimes, after a certain point, clients don't have attorneys to sort of file in those timing requirements. So they are often past those deadlines. And once you get past those deadlines, you can't get back into court. There are these time bars. So when I say that this is 3,000, it's just, the tip of the iceberg. I mean, I think there has to be, we know that there are this many, there must be a lot of other people who aren't fortunate enough to get back into court, who are sitting in prison, but because of our sort of the appellate system and making it difficult to get back into court, or are sort of stuck lingering. in court. Just to sort of, I'm sorry, I wasn't paying attention to time. I can run, I'm getting close to the 30 minutes, but sort of some sort of case studies on how these things happen. You know, the Jeffrey Deskovich case is a very well-known case in New York. And Mr. Deskovich was 17 at the time. I think it should be noted that he's now, he graduated law school and is a practicing lawyer, is in the process of doing that. But this was a case where the, you know, they really focused on Jeffrey as a suspect, even after sort of DNA testing proved that it wasn't him. And it took sort of a hit to a convicted offender that sort of exonerated Mr. Deskovich. Dewey Bissell was a case that I talked about, incentivized witnesses, where his case was overturned on Brady ground. And what that meant is that the state was in possession of what's called exculpatory evidence, evidence that was favorable to Mr. Bissell that they didn't give to the defense attorney that could have made a difference at trial. And his case was completely based on that sort of, we call it pejoratively snitch testimony, but incentivized witness testimony, jailhouse informant testimony for his conviction. Kurt Blesworth is a well-known, I think he was the first person on death row exonerated. And his case was based on eyewitness misidentification evidence. Someone saying he was the perpetrator when he wasn't. Yeah, one of the things we sort of talked about this with eyewitness misidentification, I think there's a perception that when you see something, you remember it, and that human memory doesn't sort of behave that way, that there's a lot of factors that impact actually your ability to perceive and remember things, which is sort of the heart of the, like the case that, you know, usually these cases and the crimes are committed not in optimal scenarios to actually perceive, observe, and remember, that stress has a very adverse impact on your ability to remember and process. And there's a lot of research on that. But, you know, people think that if they go, someone goes in court and says that's the person who did it, that that has a lot of weight. And this is sort of talking about, these next slides are about the sort of improper forensics and their contribution to it. And it's sort of going, you know, I think people watch CSI, they have a sort of belief that these, that cases are sort of, that there's a sort of these sorts of sciences that exist that can sort of easily sort of identify a person. One of the things is sort of forensic odontology. Well, this case, Mr. Friss's case, is a case where they use hair comparisons, that they sort of hair from the crime scene compared to Mr. Fritz and seeing that, and they sort of compare and they can say, oh, you can actually sort of identify based on this sort of microscopic analysis. And it turns out that's not the case. We did an audit and the FBI sort of acknowledged this, that there are actual problems with the ability to sort of make that comparison. So that, you know, people think that's a possibility, but sometimes it's like too good to be true. Same as the case with forensic odontology, that sort of bite mark. If someone leaves a bite mark, you can sort of get someone else's sort of teeth mold and compare it to a bite mark and say if it was a person. But that sort of comparison, which has been used on cases, is actually not accurate. And the Texas Forensic Science Commission called a moratorium to that. And there have been national reports that have been very critical of that sort of evidence. So that's, you know, I think that's the, one of the things that we sort of try to hone in on is looking at where are there avenues where there are these perceived forensic sciences that are going too far and are leading to convictions, and sort of educating courts and legislators and the public that we got to sort of get these things out of the system because they're leading to wrongfully convicted people to go to prison. I know I ran through that pretty quickly. I didn't keep track of time very well, but I'm happy to answer any questions that people have.
Great. That was great. Any questions? Carol Olward, you're on mute.
I saw her. How does what you do relate to Brian Stevenson's Equal Justice Institute?
I mean, there may be occasions where we met, there might be a case or an issue to sort of collaborate on, but they sort of do different things. I actually used to work down in like Georgia and Alabama before law school, and I was a little bit better tuned into Brian and their work. I mean, they sort of do death penalty appeals in Alabama, I think, foundationally. And I think they do sort of broader educational initiatives. Like they do, I think, nationwide litigation on juvenile death penalty or juvenile sentencing thing. And I know they do a lot of stuff on racial justice. So there could be a case, I can imagine, that there might be us to collaborate, or maybe there might be an issue in Alabama that we might be able to sort of lend some help on. But we don't, to the extent your question is like, do we collaborate? Is there a sort of a lot of intersection? There isn't usually, I guess, is the best answer.
Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Nan, you're on mute.
Thank you for your presentation. How is your organization funded? I would imagine that these cases take a lot of resources.
They do. They take a lot of resources. DNA testing costs a lot of money to sort of test it, and the sort of ability to work up cases and all of that is expensive. We get them generally through private donations. People will, you know, people are quite generous and have sort of will donate sort of money. So it's usually that way. We may have foundations as sort of supporters, but I think by and large it's by individual donors, large and small.
Rob Williams.
And then thanks for the work that you're doing. In terms of resources, could you comment a little bit on the extent to which you work with lawyers in private practice and where those firms might be?
So that's a great question. There
Says
are
the lawyer in private practice.
I've been, my firm worked on the Purvis Payne case. Now, I'm not sure if that's if that's one that your office is working on or if it's one of your affiliates, but I'm curious if there's an update on that case, because I know the stay of execution is supposed to end in April.
Actually, it did pass the action. I think it was the 9th, if I'm not mistaken. So our office is involved with that. I think there are a couple of other offices also involved with that. He has a bit of a team. So to answer your question, as far as where we are with Purvis Payne, I think the state, that's a case out of Tennessee, just to give some people an idea of that. A death penalty case out of Tennessee where there appeared to be a credible claim of innocence that we got involved with about a year ago, I think during the pandemic, or if not a little bit before, and asked, and there was, this kind of is an example of what I was sort of describing about litigating and trying to get the prosecutor and the court to agree to conduct DNA testing on evidence. And it involved finding the evidence that was believed to exist, having someone recover that, and then asking the court to test it because, and Robert, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but the state was contested the necessity to test the DNA. So you actually had to file it. They actually had to file contested motions. I think right now with Purvis's case that they're waiting to see next. My understanding is it's a waiting, they're in a holding pattern, if you will, because that stay was, has passed. I don't know what they're doing by way of the DNA evidence with that. That's not a case I'm on, so I don't know the internal sort of strategy with that. But Robert brings up a good point that, and you know, some number of our cases, we will work with law firms who have tremendous resources and in some circumstances, expertise. You know, they're sort of patent lawyers and things of that nature who have some expertise in sciences, and we'll sort of get their help in litigating these cases because of, as was asked, there's a lot of they're very resource intensive. And I think law firms like to work on these sorts of cases. And we've had some great relationships with law firms with that.
Great, thank you.
Wayne, go ahead.
Question I have is, you mentioned that you have 11 people who work on the screening team. Are they attorneys or what is their professional background?
They're not attorney. There's one attorney on that. She has sort of a special role, but they're not attorneys. They're a mix of people. Some of the folks have been at the Innocence Project since, you know, before sort of called the Innocence Project, and they've been sort of at it in terms of sort of corresponding with clients. They have, you know, through that experience have developed expertise in sort of getting documents and things of that nature. So we've had some folks who've been here for a very long time. We have some certain level of people who are sort of recent college grads who might be going to law school or something like that, or grad school of some sort, and they sort of are part of that team. So it sort of is a big sort of, it's a wide variety of skill sets that go into that job in that department.
Any other questions? Well, thank you very much for your presentation. I thought it was very interesting and very enlightening. So really appreciate you spending time with us today.
Thank you for inviting me. It was a pleasure to speak with you guys. Nice meeting you.
Thank you, Ed.